New Orleans Jazz National Historical Park is pleased to feature Dr. Bruce Raeburn and musician Barry Martyn in the limited educational series about New Orleans funerals, parades, and second lines. Dr. Raeburn conducts a majority of the lecture within the New Orleans Jazz Museum performance venue next to a podium that houses a laptop, a large projector screen, and Mr. Martyn seated on the right side of the viewer screen. As the slide and short videos are shown, both of the historians share insights and stories that share the significance of these activities within the musically infused culture. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the following educational video.
New Orleans Jazz National Historical Park. Funeral Parades and Second Lines, Part 3. Segregation in New Orleans Jazz.
When we're talking about jazz origins, though, we have to talk about the black community, because that's where the primary impulse for jazz comes from. Jazz attracted young people of all ethnic and racial backgrounds, but the people in the African-American community and the French Creole community were the ones that were the groundbreakers that really created the idiom in the period from about 1900 to 1917, when it was recorded for the first time. So we would say, this is a black brass band. But in fact, if we dig a little deeper, we find out there's a lot of diversity within this community of musicians.
It was a bit rough to know the black musicians, because it was illegal. You couldn't go to their house. I mean, imagine that. If you were black, I can't come to your house, knock on the door and say, Mr. Raeburn, Dr. Raeburn, how did you start in this? You couldn't do that. The cops would ask you what you were doing there. And so I got a paper. Lucky I had this piece of paper from the archive, where he's now the one in charge, and it said I could go to visit.
It was from the superintendent of police.
Yeah.
Basically a safe passage so that he could enter and members of our archive staff could enter the homes of black musicians and the bars where they perform without being harassed by the police force. When Barry arrived here, he joined the Black Musicians Union, Local 496. There were still Jim Crow unions when he first got here. They did not merge until 1969-70, which gives you another perspective on the racial situation here. But it was clear to Barry from the beginning that the musicians he wanted to play with, they were all members of 496, not 174, the white local, and so it made sense for him to join that local. And he could, because the board at the black local admitted white musicians. However, the white local did not admit black musicians. Originally, the brass band funerals were something that existed in both the white and black communities in New Orleans. Over the course of the teens and in the 1920s, the white community became detached from the funeral tradition. And so really, from the late teens on, when bands like in 1920, the Eureka Brass Band was formed, this tradition we're talking about survived primarily in the black community. When you go into the oral history interviews that were done with these musicians, they were very interested in each other. And particularly since there was so much music being performed in the streets during Mardi Gras and in brass band parades, black and white musicians took notes from each other. Everybody wants to be like the good players. Out at Millenburg in the 19-teens and 20s, and all the camps they would have on Sunday afternoons, they would have like crab boils and crawfish boils and whatnot, and they would hire bands, and they'd drink beer and eat seafood, but the bands could all hear each other. And this gentleman here, Paul Barbaran, who was the son of Isidore Barbaran we saw with the Omberg, was one of the musicians with black bands playing out there. And in his interview, he says, this was one of the best opportunities for us to sort of listen to everybody in town, because we couldn't play publicly in bands with them, but when we could hear them in public situations, we learned things, and they learned from us, too. And so this has always been, I think, the desire of New Orleans musicians, is get beyond the racial boundaries. And what they want to do is play with the people who can really play. Musicians often set a different model for the rest of the population. And it's always been our profound hope that people who are attracted to jazz will learn these lessons, which is, once you get beyond getting hung up on race and start talking about the beauty of talent and expressing yourself musically, then you're on a much higher level all the way.